So do you get to see movies at all while you're here? No, I don't.
I actually had a bad bronchitis, and I take prednisone right away to get rid of it. Yeah. I mean, you're not supposed to, but I always call my pulmonologist and ask him to prescribe heavy doses of prednisone. Do you know about the prednisone? Do you ever see Nick Ray's movie Bigger Than Life with James Mason?
Yeah.
That was actually a movie generated by the prednisone controversy because it had just come on the market, and among other benefits, there are some dangers. One of which is high degree of volatility and rage. And in the movie, remember, James Mason is brutal to his son and terrifies his son. That was a kind of warning against prednisone.
Yeah.
So I got on prednisone before I came here. So I said, I better stay in my room unless I'm having an interview or at a movie, or I may do something that'll detract from everything else that's happening.
Well, you get a lot of press, though.
Yeah, no, that's right. But I know that prednisone, you partly know you're disturbed,
right.
But it, not enough to stop yourself. And things that would normally seem highly irrational, you look and say, so. Yeah, I shot him, and then what? What's your point? You know.
So Phil was on it. Phil Spector may have been on it.
That's entirely possible. It's used for Bell's palsy, for ulcerative colitis, and for asthma.
Interesting. So it's worked for you outside of the fact.
Yeah,
you might have brain.
It works for the lungs. It goes to the brain.
Yeah. So speaking of working for the lungs and going to the brain, working to the body and then going to the
brain. Right, yeah.
This movie is kind of extraordinary in many ways, just because it's so straightforward.
Yeah.
You know, the idea that Michael doesn't have any pretense about him.
Right.
And he doesn't have the artifice.
Right, exactly.
To hide anything.
That's exactly, there is no filter through which his consciousness is projected into the audience. It comes through raw. And in fact, there was an early time when I actually thought of calling the movie Tyson Unplugged, but then I thought that was oxymoronic anyway, you know, and that, no, not oxymoronic, redundant.
Right.
That it was redundant because he has never been, that particularly after he got out of prison, because there was no real guile before, and I knew him from the time he was 17, 18, but when he snapped, and he talks about going insane when he was in prison in the movie, in a very harrowing way, you know, where he says insanity was my only sanity, and these kind. After that, because he never really returned from that state of consciousness, first time we met, which was when I was on the set of The Pickup Artist. I was directing The Pickup Artist, and he came by to meet Downey. And he was fascinated by, I told him about my LSD experience when I was a sophomore at Harvard, going insane for 8 days. And he was very persistent in trying to get at what I meant by the word. What does it mean when you say you're insane? What does it mean when you say you're mad? And finally I said to him, after trying to describe it as I have to many people, the only way you will ever know is if you go insane, and then you know. People who call other people insane don't know what they're talking about. They may be sociopathic, which is something entirely different. Insanity has nothing to do with behavior. You can be, as Mike was, sitting in a cell alone and be insane. You can be shooting 50 people because you don't like the way they look, and you're not insane at all. You're just sociopathic. You just have no moral sense or social sense. But real insanity is internal. He snapped in prison, and he didn't unsnap. I got an intravenous antidote after 8 days, which it didn't bring me back to where I was, but it brought me way back.
Did you get it back at will, or did you get that antidote at will, or did somebody?
Oh, I was seeking help because I would have blown my brains out. I was on my sixth day or seventh day. I actually said, even though I don't know that I'm not going to feel this way after I'm dead, which was my fear, otherwise I would have done it on the second day, I mean, I'd have to take the chance, because it seemed possible that even death wouldn't end this feeling. So I didn't do it, but I was about to do it, and then I called my mother, and I said, you've got to find someone who knows something about LSD, because I went up to the Holyoke Center, and the wall-eyed imbecile who was posing as a doctor there was so ignorant and so sadistic, threatened to put me in a straitjacket, which was, and I got out of there in 2 seconds. And my mother found out, this is a miracle, that the two guys who synthesized LSD in Switzerland in 1938, Hoffman and Rinkel, Hoffman just died 2 years ago at the age of 104. Rinkel, Hoffman was in Germany, Rinkel was in Newton, Massachusetts, 10 miles from where I was. What were the odds on that? Head of Mass General Biochemical Psychiatry Unit, head of the Biochemical Psychiatry Association of America, the guy that the CIA and the Army had put in charge of experimentation with LSD during World War II. I called him up, and he said, come right over to my house, and I did, and he gave me, I had to sign a paper, this is all in Harvard Men, I use this in Harvard Men, there's a scene with John Neville and Adrian Grenier, which is exactly the way it happened. I had to sign a paper, in case I should die as the result of the medication administered to me by Dr. Max Rinkel of Newton, Massachusetts, I hereby absolve Dr. Rinkel of all responsibility in my death. And I said, what are the chances that I'm going to die? He said, very good. And I said, good that I'm going to live or that I'm going to die? He said, that you're going to die. I said, you mean like 50-50? He said, more like 10 to 1. And I said, 10 to 1 that I'm going to die? He said, yes. I said, well, then why should I do it? And he said, do you want to feel like this for the rest of your life? I said, I can't stand to feel like this for another 2 seconds. And I pulled out the loaded 38 that I've been carrying around. I said, I've been walking around with this to my head all week. He said, well, then sign it and roll up your sleeve. And I signed it and rolled up my sleeve, and he had it ready, and he took 7 minutes to go in. And at around the third or fourth minute, I felt it working. And then I passed out, and I woke up 37 hours later on his couch. And it was different, but it was functional. It was with work. Mike did not have that. And one of the effects is that the idea of censoring what you say doesn't even penetrate the surface of your consciousness. It to say that he's raw and straightforward, there's no choice. If you said to him 6 seconds before he answered a question, remember, you're going to say that, but you're not going to say that, it wouldn't even penetrate. It would not be in his brain. He's still going to say exactly what's
that
on his mind.
True of him when he was a kid.
Not to nearly. I knew him before the. Yeah. That's why I say it was before and after. Before he went to prison, it wasn't that he was manipulative or filled with guile, but he knew the difference between answering a question this way and this way, and he that was gone. In the way I always think, these people who are shocked at the Manson murders are just incredibly naive. You take, they say, oh, but there were these innocent, the middle class girls. So what? They all did LSD. They were all on LSD. And when you want to eviscerate somebody and disembowel them, it's no big deal when you're on LSD. It's nothing. It's like, so what? You chop somebody's head off. It's part of the if you are thinking the chairs are moving anyway and that eyeballs are coming out of people's heads and you really believe it, which you do when you're hallucinating, and that your foot is going up there, then what's the big deal to take a sword and behead somebody? You know, Mike didn't need LSD. He went in without it. That's the thing. You don't need the drug.
Well, it seemed to really put him back to where he was as a 10-year-old.
That's right.
And emotionally.
That's right. Yeah. Well, he became that defenseless person without, and that's why the achievement coming out of prison was so remarkable. In a way, more remarkable than the first achievement, because that the story of someone starting down here, working his way into some phenomenal success is not that, it's unusual, but it's not. Then to crash is also not that unusual. What's almost unheard of is then getting back to the same level of fame, of strength, of success. What he didn't get back to was the same consciousness. He didn't get back to a level-headed, middle of the road functioning in the world. And that is what has plagued him, because he's gotten into more and more trouble over the years as a result, because you can't move in the social world, even if you're not a Mansonite, without those controls. And actually, Mike is a very gentle spirit and a sweet guy, and a very decent guy. He is. But But he also was trained, and this part comes through when you see one moment in the Customato section of the movie where he said, he taught me, he turned me into an animal. He said, if he asked me to bite, I would do anything for him. Mm-hmm. And it's a very sweet part of the movie, and you see Cus had a great influence on it. But you also have to recognize Customato was a very ambitious trainer. His life was training fighters. He did it his whole life. He had no personal life. He had no personal ambition in the sense that he wasn't a fighter, but he trained fighters. He had two world champions before Mike Tyson. Mm-hmm. Jose Torres, light heavyweight champion, Floyd Patterson, heavyweight champion. Mm-hmm. And he was about to get his last great and greatest champion. Mm-hmm. Here's this 13, 14-year-old kid, and Brian Hamill told me at the time, this friend of mine, he used to box up at Cuss's. Mm-hmm. Cuss said to me, this kid's going to be the greatest fighter of all time. And he said, I've watched him, and he's kind of fat, but he has incredible punch, mm-hmm. and if he stays up here and he listens to Cus, you're going to see he's going to be the youngest champion ever. And so Cus, that's all he saw. I have the next world champion, mm-hmm. of true greatness. And Mike gave himself to that guy. It was a really fascinating meeting first he thought, I'll just rip this guy off and steal from him. And then he thought, you know, I like this old white guy. He comes from here and he can do something for me and I can do something for him, and let's do it.
Well, that extreme narrow focus that he talks about in the movie, which also led to biting Holyfield and other things, analogous to Hollywood on some level, what they do with movie stars and that kind of narrow tracking of
absolutely, yeah. And of course the only difference is that he's putting his life literally on the line all the time, and the stakes, mm-hmm. are much higher because brain, mm-hmm. damage and eye damage. Right. And I remember my mother once, I was with her, and a friend of mine who was a friend of Mike's, and Mike had a huge amount of money at the time, and mm-hmm. I said to my mother that this friend was about to hit on Mike for $100,000 loan that night, and mm-hmm. that Mike was going to give it to him because he always said yes to everybody who asked for any money. And she said, well, that isn't right. And I said, what do you mean that isn't right? Why do you, mm-hmm. say that? Mike has money. And she said, yeah, but he has to get himself beaten up for it. It's not, mm-hmm. the same thing as somebody else who earned it in business or, right. something. It's a different world. Mm-hmm. And when you're saying that what you're doing is getting physically damaged in order to have money, someone shouldn't just feel, because he has it, I should be able to get it.
Well, but people get broken in different ways.
They do. That's true. I mean, you could say that about a coal miner, but...
But I mean, you think about certainly other athletes, but even in Hollywood, certainly there's that year, that period of, you know, 25 to 40.
Yes.
And that's it.
That's, you know, it. That is
wall,
it.
You hit that wall.
It is. That's right. Once you are finished, you're finished. And the interesting, mm-hmm. thing always then is, what else is there? Obviously, it's going to be anticlimactic. Mm-hmm. And the greater you are as an athlete or a movie star, whatever, the more anticlimactic it, yeah. is. And if you say you were the greatest ever, as with Tyson or with Michael Jordan or with Muhammad Ali, mm-hmm. Then what? I mean, is this person really interesting? Right. Michael Jordan, who was, if not the greatest basketball player ever, certainly maybe LeBron James will match him, but he's right up there, mm-hmm. is not an interesting guy. Mm-hmm. If he had not been the greatest basketball player ever, you would have not even the mildest interest in Michael Jordan. Whereas Mike Tyson would be a tremendously fascinating person if he had been a journeyman boxer, or if, right. he had not been a boxer at all. He's a complicated, really interesting human being.
Now, you dedicate the movie to your mom.
Yeah.
Who,
yeah.
recently passed away, sadly.
Yeah.
Is there analogy to you and Mike in this? I mean, my sense is that there's a maturity that you capture in the film, him coming to a new maturity finally. You've been known for running around, for being a wild guy in town, and all that stuff.
Well, I've always had my closest relationship has always been with my mother, because she was always the guiding force in every way from the time I was. I don't mean I listened to her all the time. In fact, I would say that if she weren't the most tolerant person on earth, relations would have ended about 100 times during the years. But she was a terrific influence and a great model, and always someone I could run things by. I always had a really good, level-headed response, although I would say I accepted it and followed it maybe 12% of the time. Mm-hmm. But my fear when she died was that I would go really nuts, because there were a lot of things I didn't do because of her. I thought, I can't do that because that would really damage her, you know. And I thought, now that she's not here, what is there to stop me from anything? If I feel like killing someone, why would I not do it? Well, you might get arrested. Who gives a fuck? I'll shoot the person who comes after me. And I thought, I better get myself on track right now to make a movie, because it's the only, when I make a movie, nothing else exists. I make movies faster than anybody else, for less money than anybody else, and better technically. I mean, if you look at the actual aesthetic of my films, and I shoot them in 10 days, 15 days, people don't even, they have screen tests that last as long as my movies take to make, you know. So so I become the opposite extreme. I said, that's what I must do now. But what? How? You need money. Okay, how much money do I have? That was my first question. I have enough money to finance a movie. I could think, I get my hands on $2 million. Okay, so what can I do for $2 million? And I started thinking about different, and then I realized Mike, and we talked about doing this for a while, had this arrest in Phoenix on drugs. He had been put in rehab for the first time. I knew the difference between him meditative and tranquil and him frantic. And the frantic is interesting and smart, but there's no way you sit him down for 10 hours or have him walk on a beach quietly for 6 hours. You have him for 60 seconds. So I thought, in a rehab, it's possible. Get him off with a I might be able to, so I said, are you ready? I mean now, because my mother died, you're there. If I can get you out of rehab for a few days, will you, you know, and he'd have to go back at night. And yeah, I'm ready. So that the movie never would have existed if those two things hadn't happened, if my mother hadn't died and if Mike hadn't been in rehab. And then they came together. And in a way, we kind of saved each other because it gave him something to think about other than, I'm really fucked up. I've blown it. I'm crashed again. And now I'm fucking pathetic. I'm sitting here in a fucking rehab at the age of 40. What has happened to me? So instead of him being down there and my saying, what can I do to pay back the world for the fact that my mother isn't alive? There's a great line when Mussorgsky did Pictures in an Exhibition. He railed against the fact that this friend of his had died, and he said, here there are ants crawling on the ground, and yet my mother isn't here. My friend isn't here. So the best movies, I think, come out of not mutual need, but mutual use. Because if an actor is thinking, I'm doing this guy a big favor, you know, I should be paid more, my career is here and his is here, he's going to be half himself at best. If a director is thinking, I'm giving this guy a huge break, what would he be without me? And people think that way all the time, and these ridiculous power levels. I'm the guy on the set, not you. You need me more than I need you. It's a horrible sort of vile atmosphere that you feel on most movie sets. I try to keep that totally away from my own and out of my own head. But here was a perfect case of two friends at this point in our lives saying, this is the match. It's silly to ignore that stuff. I mean, you take Downey and me now. You know, Downey would not exist as an actor without me. I mean, I found him. He was a reject on Saturday Night Live. He was about to be fired. In fact, he was fired. And I gave him a lead in a big movie that Warren Beatty was producing with Harvey. And that made him legitimate. He got less than zero because of that, and we became very, very close friends. Then we did Two Girls and a Guy. When did I give it to him? The part right out of rehab. No one wanted to use him. He couldn't get insured. I put up the insurance money. Same thing with Black and White. Right out of prison, no one would use him. I put up the insurance money. Okay, I was aware of that all the time. I hope I never let him feel, look at what I'm doing for you. No one else would do this. Everyone else is telling me I'm crazy. But it's still there on some level. He certainly knew it was there. Now, Downey is where he is. Does Downey say, on some level, well, does Toback want to use me right now? Is there something that that he needs me for that I can do? I should, or does he say, well, right now, I really want to do $150 million movies. If I go to a studio and say, I want to do $150 with Toback, they'll say, do we have to have Toback? Isn't it? Can't we get, you know? So that kind of thing is always at work. And the best, I think, collaborations are when you can eliminate that totally by a few, and that's where Mike and I were with this.
But isn't that the kind of same fear that Mike talked about in the movie of that? You know, the people on the set and the power game and the constant thing that people are really just afraid of losing their position and what's going to happen next.
Yes, and you can't really eliminate that. It's part of human nature, and it's part of a competitive environment, and all these are competitive environments.
Well, Hollywood is a lot like, you know, being a movie star. The idea of being a movie star is a lot like being a prize fighter or whatever.
It is
all the way up here, or
absolutely all the way bottom. And I was thinking, I had this conversation with Norman Mailer shortly before he died, and Norman was the great kind of literary influence in my life, and Norman was saying, you know, if you look at the 20th century, there were three great positions you could have: mm-hmm. President of the United States, biggest movie star in the world, and heavyweight champion of the world. Those were the three kind mm-hmm. of if you had to say, you know, you a mother is giving birth to a child, your child can have one of three great things. What are the three great? Those would be the three things to have. That's right. Yeah. Right. Yeah. But that's what's fascinating to me, I think, about this second achievement of Mike's. It's not just that he regained the title, even that's always a big deal, regaining a title when you've lost it, mm-hmm. but regaining a title when you have gone down so far and been in prison and coming back in this completely almost dreamlike state in another realm of consciousness and coming back again. And now what? It's that look at the end of the movie. It's as if he survived an earthquake, yeah. and he's looking at the city that he lived in, and there's all this rubble, and there are some structures left. Mm-hmm. And he said, well, what do I have? And then he sees, and I said, well, my kids over there, that would be nice, and it'd be nice to see them have children. Yeah. But it doesn't resemble what was there before.
Well, it's fascinating. One of the things I think is most interesting about the picture is late in the movie when he's saying in the narrative, you know, I took these fights for money.
Right.
But then you actually see him at the fight talking to Larry Merchant afterwards or whatever, saying, oh, yeah, I just took them a fight for money.
You're yes, like, right.
You think maybe it's bullshit.
Right,
and
yeah.
And then
right.
It's right there.
That's again where he's not capable. The only lie he tells in the movie, and it's not in the movie, it was from a prior interview before the Lewis fight, which he took for money. It was the first fight, big fight he took for money. And the guy said, are you up for this? Are you right? He said, yeah. His voice gets like up four octaves, you know. He can't even absolutely can't even say that. Yeah, you know.
How many interviews did you actually, how many sit downs?
We did 3 days, 10 hours a day.
So it seemed like in a couple, or particularly early on in the picture, I guess, maybe he told, I don't know if he's told his story in chronological order, but he seems to be avoiding eye contact a lot. And then by the third one, he seems to have relaxed and...
Well, we had two cameras, so some of the time he's looking right at a camera. That's why. Yeah. No, it was pretty much chronological, and it was almost a hypnotic state. I mean, mm-hmm. I would say... what I tried to do was make him not feel he was being shot. So mm-hmm. there were only the minimal number of people physically there. Yeah. And then I sort of was off to the side where he couldn't see me. Mm-hmm. And I was speaking very, very quietly. And mm-hmm. I would say, okay, so, you know, we can start. And sometimes I didn't. I just look at Larry McConkie and just like that, and we would just start. And then I would just say to Mike, oh, you remember, and he would not even realize that we were shooting. And many times, when he knew we were shooting, I never said the word cut, but he would feel he'd sort of finished, but I wouldn't say anything. And instead of saying, do you want some more, because I was kind of making myself invisible, he would wait and wait, and some of the strongest things came after 2 or 3 minutes of sitting there and saying nothing. Like when he starts to hyperventilate and then says, which to me is the most powerful moment in the movie, that no one would ever fuck with him again because I would fucking kill him. And mm-hmm. he says, he's a chug, he says, I can't even say it.
Yeah.
And then he waits for it, and then he says
choking
it.
Choking in his throat.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
Yeah, and the breathing, you know, he says he was an asthmatic, as a kid, had trouble mm-hmm. breathing, and you feel that, and sort of, halfway through the first day of shooting, and my ear, the earphones on, and I was hearing the sound very clearly, and I thought, that's the end of the movie. It just hit me right at that moment, because mm-hmm. I was always wondering, you always wonder how you're going to end a movie, and I had no clue. And at that moment, I said, if I take that room downstairs, because I knew we were going to shoot down there mm-hmm. in the lower level of the house, and light it that way, and just let the sound and his face, let the breathing go. Mm-hmm. And those last, in fact, I can't remember finally whether we decided on 5 or 6 breaths, but mm-hmm. we kept going back and forth, just rhythmically of 5 or 6 breaths, and right. then it goes dark. But it's the breathing is a very powerful part of it. And he talks about in the fight, fortunately, most of his fights ended early because he'd have trouble breathing. And you can see in the fights that didn't, the thing that was troubling him most, you watch some of these fights in the sixth and seventh round, and he's trying to get his breath, and he can't really do it because he had a chronic lung problem.
And get that energy back.
And as most sports, respiration is a major part of it.
Yeah.
People survive because they're breathing better than the guy they're against.
Yeah, the amazing shape that they're in.
Yes,
stunning.
Right.
Still,
yeah.
When you actually get near these guys, it's like everybody thinks that guy sucks at this.
I know, like, and then you say, I know.
The level of the bad guys
is
so high.
That came, I remember when I was living up at Jim Brown's house, and there was a guy who was a pretty good ball player, but not great, named Mike Warren, who played for UCLA, and then he played in the pros for a little while. And Mike Warren would come up and shoot.
He was on Hill Street Blues also?
Yes, right. And Mike Warren would come up to shoot baskets at the house. And he was like a good ball player, but, you know, just dribbling around and shooting, he'd hit 35 shots in a row from 30 feet out, you know. It was just, and God, you think, and this is, and then when you say it was really great, like when I used Ray Allen and Harvard Man, I think he shot something like 55 in a row when we were shooting, because we were shooting and warming up. And I said, just hit some outside shots. He said, well, how many do you want me to do? And I said, just keep doing. And he didn't miss one. It just kept over and over and over.
Speaking of Jim Brown, when I ran into some female critics the other night.
Yeah.
And we were talking about what we were doing, and I told them we were going to sit down with you.
Yeah.
And they all immediately, one of them said, I won't mention what her name was, but it was like, make him tell you about Jim Brown's cock size. It was like, they were still like a little angry at you.
Yeah.
There's still a feminist backlash going on with you.
Yeah.
Do you feel that anymore? Do you feel you deserved it? Or?
I think the ideology of personal relations has always been so boring to me, and such a kind of defense against really dealing with people on a one-to-one basis. Mm-hmm. And the categorization of people has always seemed to me to be a kind of pathetic and lame way of dealing with people. I mean, you can have an agenda politically, but it's the old, you know, Robespierre thing of he loved humanity, but he hated human beings. Mm-hmm. And the whole notion of understanding people you don't know, of thinking you understand things you don't understand, of pontificating in worlds where you have no experience, where you wouldn't know how to serve. Mm-hmm. It's actually what Mike says to that guy in the press conference when he snaps. Mm-hmm. And I don't know, the line isn't really clear. I couldn't make it any clearer, but the line that provokes it is that reporter yells out at him, you belong in a straitjacket. Mm-hmm. And he says, your mother belongs in a straitjacket. And then he goes back and forth. And the guy was terrified, and you can, even without seeing, you can see the guy say, you know, he said, you couldn't survive for one day in my world. Mm-hmm. And that anger, which comes towards when you say to somebody, oh, who the fuck are you? What do you know about me? What do you know? What do you know other than some fantasy of what you think you know about my world? Or like when this moron Amy Taubin was railing on about Mike Tyson being a rapist. How does she know? Mm-hmm. He was convicted. Oh, you mean Amy Taubin actually believes that every human being that was convicted of every crime was guilty?
And vice versa.
That she has this, that's where it becomes so absurd. She has this 100% worshipful belief in the immaculate justice and truth of the criminal justice system.
Well, it matches her belief. Yeah. With everybody else. I think we saw that through the whole political season.
Yeah.
Very much that, you know, if you believed in John McCain or the right wing,
right,
that Sarah Palin was brilliant.
Right.
You hated her. Yes. You know, what the truth of her was somewhere that we probably never even saw.
Right, but I always say when people say that there was a famous little, I shouldn't say famous, interesting episode that crystallizes this. When I was with my father had known Nixon. He was a lifelong Democrat, but he worked at Dreyfus and Company, which is a big brokerage firm. And Jack Dreyfus was Nixon's biggest financial backer and friend. And so my father met Nixon on many occasions. And my father's an extremely handsome guy. And after my father died, I was coming out of the ocean in Key Biscayne. I'd flown down for the weekend. I was very thin then. I had a little bikini bathing suit on, very long hair, and I'm coming out of the ocean at dusk, and there's Nixon walking down the beach. Nobody else is there, and he's walking a dog. He has his suit on with a tie. The pants are rolled up here, and he's walking his dog with a scotch, and he sees me. And I know he doesn't recognize me. I've met him like two or three times, and he's thinking, who is that, you know, on my beach? And as we're getting closer and closer, squinting at me, and I said, James Toback, Erwin Toback's son. He said, oh my God. He said, oh, I was so sorry to hear about your father passing away. And then he went on to a two-minute peon to my father's appearance. He was so handsome. That hair, those eyes, that skin, even his posture, his clothes just went on and on and on. And I said, yeah. And then, and I'm his breath is very powerful, reeking of sky. And then I could not resist. So I said to him, you know, I have to say, I don't understand how you handled all the venom towards you. But if I had been in your position, I just would have said, fuck it, and blown up the whole fucking planet. And he said, with after maybe 10 seconds of pause, I thought of it, but that would have been wrong. And it was such an eerie moment. Mm-hmm. I didn't tell anyone about it except Warren Beatty, who's very close friend. And I said, but do not tell anybody. And Beatty's one of the few people on Earth who, if you say don't tell, will not tell anybody. Mm-hmm. He's 100%. So, which is why he knows more secrets than anybody, because people know he really won't. So several years later, Gary Hart's the front runner for the Democratic nomination. And he's up in Warren's room at the Beverly Wilshire Hotel, and I'm there. And Warren says, tell Gary that Nick says, sorry, come on. I said, nah, I said, come on. I said, okay. So I tell him the story, and Gary Hart said, and without missing a beat, he said, he didn't say that. And I said, really? And he said, he couldn't have said that. I said, I didn't notice you. Where were you standing? And my point in telling the story is, it's that thing of like Amy Taubman saying, he's guilty, he's a rapist. I would say, which closet were you hiding in? Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, who knows what happened in that room? Two people, right. The two people who were there. And yet there is this tremendous arrogance all the time that people have. It's like people, you've been to Lithuania and you've spent 3 months there, mm-hmm. and you start telling someone you were, oh, and they start telling about Lithuania. Well, when were you there? Well, I wasn't, but I know it, you know. And by the way, the coda to that was, I felt that Gary Hart, I said to myself, by the way, the reason he gave that Nixon didn't say it, he mm-hmm. said, I once played the piano with him. And I said, and? He said, mm-hmm. well, we played the piano together. He never would have said that. So, but what I thought was, after that, he doesn't want to think that he's about to get a job, President of the United States, right. where it's a realistic possibility that he might have to make a decision of whether or not to nuke somebody. Mm-hmm. And therefore, he doesn't want to hear that another president had that possibility. Right. And I believe, in my quick psychoanalysis of Gary Hart, and I don't know what else the reason would be, that that's why he sabotaged himself so aggressively. Because who has ever blown a legitimate shot at the presidency as willfully as he did? Remember, he invited the reporters.
Clinton tried.
He tried. But Clinton would lie. No, Gary Hart invited them. Yeah. He said, you don't believe me? Follow me. Yes. And they did. And he said, here, see? And so, but why would you do that? Because secretly you do not want to be president. And why do you not want to be president? Because someday you're going to have to say, should I nuke them or should I not nuke them?
I kind of wonder whether McCain made that choice with Sarah Palin also.
Yes, that's right.
When you see that, at first it seemed like a good idea, then you're like, right. It's really a bad idea for
yes,
this guy.
You're right.
To drag him right down.
Yeah.
So do you live to make movies, or do you make movies to live?
Both. It's a very interesting way of, I'd never thought of that before, but it's true. If you told me I was absolutely forbidden to make another movie, I'm not mm-hmm. saying I would end my life, but I'm saying I would now have to really scrounge around to find a justification. What's mm-hmm. going to, and on the other hand, when I make movies, I don't make them to live financially, because right. I wouldn't eat, but I make them so that life can be fun and exciting. And the in-between period to me, it usually is 3 years, but it's not that I'm not doing something. I'm gestating. I'm deciding, should it be this mm-hmm. or that? I'm not waiting for scripts to come in. I'm waiting to decide what script to write, whom to use, and my whole life is dedicated to that. And it's you know, I was 27 before I did anything. I mean, mm-hmm. I went through Harvard. I married this girl who was the granddaughter of the Duke of Marlborough, lived in Blenheim Palace, moved in the Hollywood Hills with Jim Brown. Mm-hmm. I was having a ball. But all of a sudden, I woke up one morning in bed with Leroy Kelly, a running back for the Cleveland Browns, and mm-hmm. two girls, and said to myself, this is fun, but what am I doing? Mm-hmm. And that was the day I literally drove out to Broad Beach, went in the ocean, and mm-hmm. said, I'm going to make movies. It just kind of hit me. And I wrote a script called The Gambler. Mm-hmm. Carol Rice got a hold of it. I moved in with Carol Rice, practically moved in, spent a year with him as his acolyte, mm-hmm. learned everything I know about movies from spending 2 years with Carol Rice before, during, and after The Gambler, which mm-hmm. he directed. And then I said, that's it. That's my life. I now know what it is. That's mm-hmm. why I'm here. And that was 1973. So it's now 35 years later, and I never had a second thought.
And has it gotten more personal for you? Or, I mean, I don't know what kind of assignments you're taking, because obviously, you're, you know, I'm sure you're doing some rewrites that...
No, never, 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 never. No, I don't believe in it, because I think that I've had the opportunity on many occasions, including mm-hmm. when I've needed a lot of money, and I could have made a lot. Mm-hmm. I do not believe that it doesn't affect, let's put it this way, it would affect me adversely. Mm-hmm. I can't lie in my work. I can lie in life in a way that Mike can't. I cannot lie in my work. You might not like what I'm doing. So I can't make a case for something that I don't believe, or have a movie end the way I don't believe it would end. And to me, taking a job for somebody else, being a hired hand, there's an interview that Quentin Tarantino he interviewed me in the new issue of Film Comment. It's very, mm-hmm. I think it's a good interview. I think mm-hmm. it's going to come out this week. And I say at the end to him how lucky he and I both are, mm-hmm. because we've been able to do whatever movies we've wanted to do, and at whatever, no prepackaged lunches, mm-hmm. only what we want to do. And that, once you give that up, I don't believe you're the same person when you go back to it. I wouldn't mm-hmm. be. If I sat around for a month the way Mamet does, the way some other guys do, basically just saying, the director wants this, give him that. He wants this, give him mm-hmm. that. I mean, it's a normal thing to do.
It pays for a lot of houses.
Yeah, but I couldn't do it. I don't care. The houses to me are empty. Who mm-hmm. cares? I grew up, I don't have money now at all, but I grew up with a grandfather who's one of the richest men in America, mm-hmm. and I had everything I needed from the even though my father didn't have money, it was around me all the time. So I grew up as if I had unlimited money till I was 18. So I saw and felt how little difference it made. It's nice to have it, and if you say you can have six houses or three, I'll take six. Yeah. But I'd also say I don't care if I have none, and I have none. I don't own anything. And I don't care, because to be in possession of is ultimately empty for me. Mm-hmm. There's an emptiness inside we all have to fill. Mike talks about that and in the movie. And if you're not filling that void inside, it doesn't matter. And only people who have never had money hold on to the fantasy that mm-hmm. if only I had money, everything would be fine. Yeah. You know, everything is a little nicer, and you don't have to worry about this instead of that. But what makes me feel great is that there's a movie I'm excited about to do.
Right. You know? Well, it's an interesting thing, because it does feel like you're kind of constantly chasing, but it's, you know, it's not, it's so personal. And again, it speaks back to the idea of the critics and people who are, you know, jumping on you personally or jumping on Mike personally and making about that. But you're, what you're really about, what you really want, is really not any part of their life.
I mean, listen, I to be honest with you, I know most film critics. I've met them over the years. I know them. The ones I've been friendly with have been the smart ones, and David Thompson, Pauline Kael. Mm-hmm. I can name quite a few that I think are very bright and I've been friendly with. Most of them are not that smart. I mean, and I say not that smart, not in relation to me or them, not that smart, period. Mm-hmm. Not that smart in relation to the driver who drove me here today. Right. Not that smart in relation to the bathroom attendant. I mean, I don't think that when you say the word film critic, it people tend to group them as a profession and say it covers it. It covers it about as much as it does saying football players or mm-hmm. stockbrokers or senators. I mean, you know, U.S. senator. Right. Is it a group and they're all the same? You know, so when you're talking about people who are either ideologically narrow and incapable mm-hmm. of seeing what's on the screen, only the agenda they're coming with, mm-hmm. or who write so badly that I can't even read them. I mean, let's put it this way. I think 3/4 of people writing film criticism mm-hmm. shouldn't be in print. They just don't know how to write a sentence well. Andrew Saras has been writing for years and years and years. He's a dreadful writer. Sentence for sentence, he can't write. Mm-hmm. He has these stupid alliterative sentences. He has a tin ear. He's a bad writer. Mm-hmm. You know, and when you compare him, forget whose opinions you agree with Pauline Kael, who is an excellent writer, right. Or David Thompson, who is a terrific writer, mm-hmm. or Rob Nelson, who is an excellent writer. I mean, there are loads of very good writers in print. You say, what are you doing, film critic? You know, and then you take out like Rex Reed. He's not a great writer, but he has a style. Yeah. He has a wit. So you read the New York Observer, and you have Rex Reed and Andrew Saras, two old timers, two dinosaurs. Yeah. One of them unreadably bad as a writer. The other one's still clever and funny. Yeah. I read Rex Reed.
Saras' ideas, I'm usually intrigued by those more than I am by Rex's.
Yeah.
But I like reading Rex.
Yeah, I mean, you can't read Andrew. He's too fucking boring. Yeah. Rex Reed, writing about anything, I read him. Yeah. It's not that he knows necessarily what he's saying, and he gushes over these obsessions he has. You know, if Elaine Stritch does something, he's going to be on his knees for 6 weeks celebrating. But sentence for sentence, Rex Reed has an ear, and he has some spark in his prose.
Of course, Elaine has driven me crazy for years because he's such a good writer and so uninterested in movies.
Who?
Anthony Elaine.
Yes, yeah,
you know,
yeah.
He's a great writer, but he doesn't care about movies, and it's like he's the guy everybody wants to be right
but
now.
But I can't read people who can't write well. I just don't. Life is too short to read, I don't know whether it's sports, movies, politics, to read people who write bad. Gail Collins, New York Times, a brilliantly hilarious, witty writer. I read her because I actually called her on the phone. I said, a couple of weeks I called her up. I said, as James, oh, hi. I said, I just have to tell you, just read your column. I said, I don't make these calls. I have been laughing for the last half hour. And I said, I want to tell you, I look forward to reading you every time. Every sentence is well sculpted and witty. You're sharp, you're funny, and you're a great writer. And she said, you have no idea how much that means to me. It's really going to inspire. The next time I have a writer's block, I'm going to think of that. And that's what I'm talking about. You know, so you say film critics, if they can't write, I don't mean as well as Gail Collins, but I mean even a fifth as well as Gail Collins, why read them? You know, let alone, they're going to tell me about me. Mm-hmm. If some moron comes up on the street and says, here's what you are.
Right.
I might listen to him as a joke, but to take it seriously.
What's the weird thing of the job, though? I mean, the idea that you are there to judge. And of course, I find it fascinating when critics get angry that studios don't show them their worst movies.
Right.
You know, they go, why aren't they showing us, you know, Paul Blart Mall Cop or whatever?
And right.
Because it's not meant for
exactly.
It's meant for people to enjoy the stupidity.
That's right. Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. That's, of course, that's part of the whole insanity of the thing, that every movie is to be addressed critically. It's absurd, as opposed to just say, I laughed for a long time. You know, what else do you have to say about nothing?
Yeah.
That's it. But by the way, I prefer those movies often to others. I mean, I will always go for a movie that makes me laugh as opposed to probably 80% of others. But, you know, when I was talking to Scott Fundus last night, who's an extremely smart guy and a very good writer, and I was thinking about that in relation, because Scott basically has a very definite slant on things. He's very passionate about people he likes, doesn't like, but it's always from a perspective of a kind of direct intelligence and receptivity to what's in front of him, not to something he decided before or thought about before. True of directors, true of actors. How do you cast a movie? Most directors, sadly, take a list. Who's on the top of the A-list? Who's next? Right. We can't get him. Is he right for the part? What do you mean by right? He's bigger than he is now, you know, as opposed to open your mind. What is this role? What can it be? How about him? You know, Ashton Kutcher. Yeah, Ashton Kutcher's a good guy. He's a serious guy. He can do some great work. Where? You know, you have to. That was true with Downey. I mean, you know, why use Downey in the lead role with all these people with a big budget?
Right.
Because there was something about, I hired him 30 seconds, something about his goofiness and his openness to humor and his wit that I just said, that's it. Power of Wu-Tang Clan. I used him in Lead in Black and White. 1 minute of conversation. He said, I've never acted before. You can't use me in the lead in this movie. Ben Stiller's in it. Downey's in it. I said, you're going to be the lead. Mm-hmm. He said, but I don't know a fucking thing about acting. I said, you don't have to. You got the part. He said, you're a crazy motherfucker. He said, you don't have to give me. He said, I'll get Wu-Tang to cooperate with you. You don't have to give me the part. I said, I know I don't have to. I want you to be in it. Mm-hmm. And I knew, and he's great in the film. I said, I'm not saying to you are a great actor. I'm saying in this movie, with me, with us doing this, you're going to be terrific in this thing.
Well, Favreau certainly has reaped the rewards of Downey.
Yes, yeah,
because
certainly
I think it's
has.
A much better acted movie than a directed movie.
Yes, probably. Yeah. Well, you know, the thing with Downey is, and ultimately Downey is going to be at a real crossroads soon. He's never going to do his great work in movies. I mean, you know, he just isn't. He'll be good because he's good in anything he's going to do that he puts his heart into. I mean, Ally McBeal, no one could be good in a piece of shit like that. But I mean, but in the stuff that he's do, this kind of stuff, he is what he is. The really great stuff, like Two Girls and a Guy, Less Than Zero, that sort of work, black and white, that comes only when you give him total free reign. And in a $200 million movie, it's tough to give any actor total free reign. Downey will reward you in direct relation to what control you give him over what he wants to do with that role. He may not know what it is. And if you give him 100% control, you get the most. It's only a film. It's not the stage. If it doesn't work, don't use it. But a lot of people think, God, it's 150. How much time do we have? Can we really afford to do that? Downey will be his best. No one will ever get as much from Downey as he can get from himself if you make him feel that he is allowed to go wherever he wants to go. And he will punish you as a director. He will punish you if he feels you're trying to limit him and not let him contribute. And he'll yes sir you and appear to be giving you what you might want. And in fact, he'll be giving you half or a third or less. Brando used to fuck with directors that way. He would tease them and toy with them on the first couple of days to test whether they really knew what his best stuff was. Right. And he'd say, which take did you like better? And if they got the wrong take, he would intentionally do two different things.
Right.
And if they told him they thought one take was better than the other take, he would just write them off from that point on. From the second day, they didn't exist for him.
Safety and freedom.
Yeah.
Kind of like the movie. Again, back to Tyson. Again.
Yeah. Absolutely.
You know? So for me, even the movies of yours that I've not liked as much, I've always felt like that's a guy you want to have dinner with. Just to shoot the shit.
Well, they're all. I mean, I have my own hierarchy of my movies. I think I've made five great movies, five good, really good movies, and three movies that are not as good as the others, and one that I really like less than all the others, but much less. That's because it's the one big mistake I made as an actor. I made one very bad actor's choice in my movies. But what is always true is that they go as far as I can get them to go, and except at the end of The Pickup Artist, which was my one failure. I did not do that. That was a test, and I tried something that I knew was probably not going to be a good idea, and it wasn't. So two mistakes, but that's not bad for 13 movies.
Not bad at all.
Ray Sharkey was the actor who died of AIDS, which he thoroughly deserved. He gave it to six girls knowing he had AIDS. Knowing he had AIDS, including his wife. And died, but it was a very crazy story. All six visited him in Palm Springs 2 weeks before he died, saying, in effect, we're here to accept your request for our forgiveness. We know what you did. We are ready to forgive you, but we want you to admit it, to explain it, and to ask for our forgiveness. And he screamed at them and said, I don't have AIDS, I have pneumonia, you're lying, I didn't give you AIDS, I don't have AIDS, get the fuck out of here. He then died of AIDS 2 weeks later, and all of them died of AIDS over the next couple of years.
All rage. Well, I guess that's what made him work as an actor when it did work.
Yeah.
Brutal. Yeah. Anyway, thank you so much for calling us away. Appreciate it.
Absolutely.